Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship in this beautiful place on this beautiful morning. Mid-August already? Can you believe that? That sounds like a complaint. Sorry.
Okay.
All right. A couple of quick announcements. The office is closed this week. And special thanks to Terry Fouts and Deb Storman, who kind of helping out doing some of her duties this morning. And Bob has been nice.
Yeah, a couple of things this morning. One of the hymns that we're doing may not be quite familiar with everyone. So if you could look at the sermon hymn in your bulletin, it's called When in Our Music God is Glorified. I'd like to play through it and let you hear the tune once, and then Pastor Bill will sing it for you, and then we'll sing it together as a group, so you just the first verse, so you get the feeling for it, and make sure that it's a familiar tune. Okay, so I'll play through it once. Traditional Latin hymn, Panis Angelicus, focuses on that. Translation, Rene will sing it in Latin at communion time, but I'll give you the translation right now. It's, may the bread of angels become bread for mankind. The bread of heaven puts all foreshadowings to an end. O miraculous thing, the body of the Lord will nourish the poor, the servile, and the humble. And that will be sung by Rene at communion time in Latin.
Okay, thank you. All right, let's rise for the greeting. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the God of manna, the God of miracles, the God of mercy.
Amen.
Drawn to Christ and seeking God's abundance, let us confess our sin. God, our provider, help us.
It is hard to believe there is enough to share. We question your ways when they differ from the ways of the world in which we live. We turn to our own understanding rather than trusting in you. We take offense at your teachings and your ways. Turn us again to you. Where else can we turn? Share with us the words of eternal life, and feed us for life in the world.
Amen. In Jesus, the manna from heaven, you are fed and nourished. By Jesus, the worker of miracles, there is always more than enough. Through Jesus, the bread of life, you are shown God's mercy. You are forgiven and loved into abundant life.
Amen.
Morning is broken.
Praise.
Ever-loving God, your Son gives himself as living bread for the life of the world. Fill us with such a knowledge of his presence that we may be strengthened and sustained by his risen life to serve you continually through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
I'm going to walk out for a moment because I realize I forgot my mask for communion, so continue on, everything's all right.
The first reading is from Proverbs. Wisdom is portrayed as a woman who invites people to partake of her banquet. Just as ordinary food is necessary for physical life, wisdom's food, insight and understanding, is necessary for fullness of life with God. Partaking of wisdom's banquet is the way to life. Wisdom has built her house. She has hewn her seven pillars. She has slaughtered her animals. She has mixed her wine. She has also set her table. She has sent out her servant girls. She calls from the highest places in the town. You that are simple, turn in here. To those without sense, she says, come eat of my bread and drink of the wine I have mixed. Lay aside immaturity and live, and walk in the way of insight. The word of the Lord. Today's psalm is from Psalm 34. We'll read it responsibly. Fear the Lord, you saints of the Lord. For those who fear the Lord lack nothing.
The lion has grown and the ox has grown. But those who fear the Lord have nothing.
Come, children, and listen to me. I will teach you reverence for the Lord.
Who among you takes pleasure in life and desires a long life to do the Lord's pleasure?
Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from lying words.
Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it.
The second reading is from Ephesians. True wisdom integrates our new reality in Christ with our Christian fellowship and daily conduct. Because we are filled with the Spirit, Christians regularly rejoice together, give thanks to God for one another, and care for one another. In this way, we revere our Lord Jesus Christ. Be careful then how you live, not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of time because the days are evil. So do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs among yourselves, singing and making melody to the Lord in your hearts, giving thanks to God the Father at all times and for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood have eternal life, and I will raise them up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate, and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Do you know what word in the English language, and we better have a former English teacher up front here, do you know what word in the English language, what noun, is the most used word of all? Time's up. It's time. The word time, believe it or not. When I was a student assistant pastor at my home church in Lebanon, Pennsylvania. What a funny thing here, I may have said this before somewhere along the line. There was one evangelical church and one United Brethren church. An alley separated them. Then the E's and the UB's came together to form the EUB, the Evangelical United Brethren. And then, later on, the two churches merged when we became United Methodist Churches, and it went from being St. Paul and Salem EUB United Methodist to Covenant United Methodist. Well, I had one grandmother in one church and one grandmother in the other. And when I was in college, I was hired as a student assistant to do junior church. I don't know if you've ever had that kind of program here, Children's Church. And we had a lovely chapel on the second floor of our church building, and we had a kind of miniature junior church every Sunday. And the same happened at the other church across the alley. So when the two merged, they had a student assistant, we had a student assistant, and so we went back and forth for a while until we both graduated from college. But I asked my grandmother, who helped out with the children's church in the other church, what would be a good thing to preach on to the kids? Now, it's kind of a children's sermon, but not just a little moral lesson. It actually was a sermon, short, but geared to the kids. And she said, speak on time. Preach on the use of time. Well, I'm going to do that today. Let's pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Making the most of your time. One of the greatest American dramas is Our Town, and by Thornton Wilder. There is an unforgettable scene in which Emily, who dies at the young age of 26, wants to return to her family for a short visit. She asks the stage manager, the narrator, if she can return for that brief visit. You can choose any day, he replies. Now, let me interrupt the story by asking you if you had an opportunity to go back in time. When would you want to go? I don't think I want to go back, personally. But, not that it was awful, I just don't know. But if I had to choose the time to go back to, it probably would be my seminary days, when I went to United Theological Seminary in Dayton, Ohio. And that June, we got married. That August, we went to Dayton, Ohio, and spent 3 years there. Ironically, this October, the seminary is celebrating its 150th anniversary, and they moved, since I was there, to another part of Dayton, and they're burning their mortgage at the same time. So my wife and I are hopeful that we can travel out there on the Sunday I'm not here in October to take part in all that. But if I were to go back, that would probably be a time. It was a good time in many, many ways. I don't know about you. Well, Emily chose to return on her 12th birthday. She returns home. Her father, back from a business trip, ignores her. He's concerned about his business problems. Her mother, Also unaware that Emily is to die at age 26 in childbirth, is busy cooking and pays no attention to her. She looks at her mother and her father and says, "I can't bear it. Oh, Mama, just look at me 1 minute as though you really saw me. Mama, 14 years have gone by since I've died, but just for a moment now, we're all together, Mama. Just for a moment, we're happy. Let's look at one another." But her father and her mother ignore her. They're too busy with their own problems to see her. So she leaves. "I can't. I can't go on," she says. "It goes so fast. We don't have time to look at one another." She breaks down sobbing, "Goodbye. Goodbye, world. Goodbye, Mama and Papa. Oh, Earth, you're too wonderful for anybody to realize you. Do any human beings ever realize life while they live it every minute?" Emily, in this monologue, expresses that life is too precious to waste, to fritter away on trivial. Life, and time that goes with it, is to be lived, not squandered. Well, that's what the writer of Ephesians seems to say to us today in our second reading. "Be careful then how you live," he writes, "not as unwise people, but as wise, making the most of the time." What does it mean to make the most of your time? Does it mean to just keep busy and move fast? You know, we middle-class Protestant, upwardly mobile achievers know all about that. Hopefully drunkenness and debauchery are not our problem, or anyone's problem in this congregation. But that may not be our brand of sin, but most of us don't have to worry about getting drunk with wine. But that's not the problem. Do we get drunk with our activities and our busyness, with things to do and places to go, with carpools for the kids and meetings and, let's face it, a little bit different. I just out of curiosity, how many of you, raise your hand, how many of you are either retired or kind of semi-retired? Raise your hand. Okay, it's just about everybody. So that part of this doesn't necessarily apply to you, except sometimes you're busy with the grandkids, helping with them, running around with them, etc., taking them to places. I don't know, a neighbor in our neighborhood that I see frequently who's taking the kids down from where we are in Jim Thorpe down to Allentown to swimming practice a couple times a week, et cetera, et cetera. And, you know, it's amazing how busy we are, even in retirement. Do you ever raise the question, how did I ever do all this? How did I ever do what I had to do when we were not retired? Of course, now we have a lot more doctor's appointments to go to than we used to. And the other problem in retirement is remembering what day it is. Fortunately, I remembered it Sunday, so that I forgot my mask, but I remembered it Sunday. Forgetfulness can be a problem, too, especially if we find ourselves too busy with too many things going on. We're probably going to miss something. But then there was the pandemic. That kind of threw a monkey wrench into the busyness, did it? We suddenly found ourselves not doing what we normally do. We couldn't go out to eat. For a while, we couldn't come to church. It felt weird, by the way, coming here on a Wednesday and doing church, recording it to be played on Sunday. What was really weird, something I was never able to do in my ministry, was to be at two places at once. To be on the video on Sunday morning from here and to serve at the other church where I am at the same time. That was kind of cool. So there were some good things about all that. But there were so many things, being with family, having social gatherings, getting together with people, and singing. Singing was a problem. We weren't able to gather and sing, and then when we did sing, we didn't ask on. At my church, we didn't sing. I'm not sure I agreed with it, but we wore masks, and my wife, who's the choir director, would read the words while the organist plays the hymn, and the congregation would either hum it or read the words with her. I'm thinking, if you're going to hum or read the words of the mass, well, you might as well sing, as long as you don't overdo it. Remember at one point, I think I gave you all the advice to sing no louder than if there were a baby sitting next to you in the pew. Just the opposite of the way we want to sing most of the time if we're singers. So, how can we make the most of the time? Hopefully we don't have to go back into all that again, but keep the masks handy, as I almost did this morning, because you never know. The writer of Ephesians tells us to avoid debauchery and getting drunk, but he also then gives us some positive advice. He encourages us to be filled with the Spirit as we sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord in our hearts. So here we are in worship this morning, taking an hour, or maybe an hour and 10 or 15 minutes, when we have communion a little longer, taking an hour, 1 hour, out of 168 hours in a week. One out of 168, not very much. Spending it in worship, and spending just part of that time singing. Admittedly, we shouldn't be spending our time in drunkenness and debauchery, but is it wise use of time to sing and make melody to the Lord? Aren't there other things that we ought to be doing and being busy about? Apparently not, at least not according to the writer of Ephesians. However, if you think singing and making music is a waste of time, and that may be how one or two of you might feel, I hope not. But if you do, you're not alone. There have been others in history who have seen singing as something negative, not as something positive. For example, you remember the Ayatollah Khomeini? Remember that guy? He declared that music is no different from opium. So he banned music from the Iranian airways. He went on to say, if you want your country to be independent, you must turn radio and television into educational institutions and eliminate music. Music makes the brain inactive. Right, Bob? Going back many centuries farther to one more famous than the Ayatollah, Plato, that great philosopher, is sort of the founding father of the anti-music department. Like the Ayatollah, Plato thought that music lulled the best part of the soul into relaxing its guard. He maintained that music gratifies the emotions and thus weakens and distracts the good citizen. Of course, some of what passes for music in our society today, you might agree with that. Even St. Augustine was an anti-music man. He was most severe in his own susceptibility to a clear voice with suitable modulation, pronouncing the delights of the ear to be a contentment of the flesh. Augustine recommended that the whole melody of sweet music be banished from my ears and the church's too. Obviously, the writer of Ephesians didn't make any inroad into his way of thinking. Now, the fact that sin and singing have only a G to distinguish them from each other has resulted in some rather interesting church typos, and I'm sure you've seen these lists, right? Give you just a couple of them. Maybe they're Freudian slips. Next Sunday, the service will feature a guitarist who can sing and play at the same time. Or how about this one? The couples club concluded the evening with group singing. Or this one, everyone can sing and feel part of the service. And again, help the congregation sing. That G makes a big difference. Other famous persons, however, have been far more positive about singing and music. For example, a man who was known for his brilliance, no less than Albert Einstein, had been asked to describe the theory of relativity in simple words so that he might at least catch a small glimpse of its meaning to this person who asked him. Einstein answered him back by saying that he could not do what the man requested, but if the man would call on him at his home in Princeton, Einstein would play it on his violin. Unlike St. Augustine, Martin Luther, who oddly enough was an Augustinian monk, had a lot different view about music, which explains why we have a fair amount of it in our service today, with the chants, etc. He wrote back in 1538, "I truly desire that all Christians would love and regard as worthy the lovely gift of music. For next to the Word of God, the noble art of music is the greatest treasure in the world." Next to the Word of God, it is the greatest treasure in the world. It controls our thoughts, minds, hearts, and spirits. He saw music as a means of making the believer more receptive to Christian doctrine. For as he put it, "God has his gospel preached also through the medium of music." My wife actually did the sermon at our church several years ago, a meditation, and in it she spoke about singing and its importance, and I asked her for her notes and actually looked up a few of the things. She likes to research things, and so here's some of her research, more contemporary view of singing. Studies showed more recently that singing has both physical and psychological benefits. It can boost our immune system. It can give us a good workout without sweat. Our lungs get a good workout. Our diaphragm gets stronger, and we can get better circulation and a more regular heartbeat. It can help, it can very much help people suffering from Alzheimer's and dementia. In addition, there are psychological and emotional benefits. It releases endorphins, good brain chemicals that can make us feel uplifted. It can help take our minds off our troubles. It can boost our morale. And one of the things is that I missed most during the pandemic was singing and choir singing. So hopefully we'll beat this thing, this latest thing, and not have to go back to all that again. So there are lots of values to singing, some of which the writer of Ephesians had no idea. By the way, back in 1722, the town council of the city of Leipzig was looking for a new cantor in the school of St. Thomas and an organist for the church of St. Thomas. The council searched for this new person, selected one, who 3 weeks later turned them down. Then they went to their second person, and he too turned them down. Then they decided, as one member of the council subsequently wrote, that since the best man could not be obtained, a mediocre one would have to be accepted. The third choice they hired, the mediocre one, was none other than Johann Sebastian Bach. Who would have thought? The pick was interesting in the history of music because, apart from the whole issue of what Bach would become later, in the early 18th century, there was a whole new kind of operatic style of music that was taking hold of churches. And in the process, it was taking singing away from the people to just professional choirs and singers, trained voices. The town council wanted to have the people more involved, so not less involved in the music life. And so Bach did precisely that. He developed what is known as the chorale. And we have some of his chorales in our hymnal. He got people involved. He actually used a love song in his St. Matthew's Passion. The one that's entitled, "Commit Thou All That Grieves Thee," was from a love song 100 years earlier, which began, Confused are all my feelings, a tender maze the cause. Interestingly enough, many of the hymns don't have religious origins. As Martin Luther once said, it's not right for the devil to have all the best tunes. And so some of the best of the old German hymns even came out of the beer halls. Well, over the years of my active ministry, one of the differences between Lutherans and Methodists seems to be, not strictly, but seems to be that the Lutheran pastors often don't choose the hymns. The organist or choir director does. And in the case of the church where I serve, the pastor gets to choose one. He chooses the hymn of the day, but the organist lines up all the rest. Well, choosing hymns was something that I got in trouble with, probably more than anything else in my ministry, because as is the case for today, I chose one that's not all that familiar. And from time to time, I would choose unfamiliar hymns. If I told you this story before, forgive me. When you get older, you repeat yourself. But there was this hymn, it may be in your hymnal too, When Jesus Came to Jordan. I think, when Jesus came to Jordan to be baptized by John. And we always sang it on Baptism of the Lord Sunday, like the second Sunday of January. And we had a first service, and there was an older woman about the third row back, and she would often give me the eye when it was a hymn she didn't like or care for. And that hymn, when we sang it, she'd go, and I could see that she didn't like. Well, as we were singing it, I happened to look down at the title of the tune, which is often at the bottom of the page, and guess what it was? Complainer. I loved it. I couldn't wait to go out at the end of the service and tell her that the name of that tune that we sang every year, so it wasn't like we never sang it before, was Complainer. It fit beautifully. Well, our founder, my church's founder, John Wesley, has in the United Methodist hymnal some rules for singing. It's printed every time it's in the hymnal. And there's some pretty good ideas in there. One of them is he said we should sing lustily, not lustfully, but lustily, which of course we shouldn't have done during the pandemic, but we hopefully can do that now, at least for a while. He says, beware of singing as if you're half dead and half asleep. At the same time, he suggests that our singing should be modest enough so that we try to unite our voice with the voices of others. And he says, sing in time. Be sure to keep with the time. Above all, sing spiritually. Have an eye to God in every word you sing. Aim at pleasing Him more than yourself. Good advice for singing. Good advice for living. Because as the Westminster Confession asks in its catechism, what is man's, humanity's chief end? To glorify God and enjoy Him forever. Well, our hymn of the day is about our music glorifying God, and that's why I chose it. So we used to have a great day of singing every year, favorite hymns and so on, but we usually included that hymn as part of that service because it has a really good message about the church, a little bit of history about how the church has used music, how music played a role in Jesus' life, and how it is a means of glorifying God. And in the process, while some people may think singing is a waste of time, the writer of Ephesians reminds us that that's a good way to make the most of the time. Let's sing that again.
When in our hearts are all
The Yah is from Yahweh, the name of God, so it means whenever you use the term hallelujah, it's praise God. The Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the church, the world, and all of creation. God of wisdom, enlighten your church. Guide theologians, biblical scholars, authors, and seminary professors as they seek greater knowledge and invite others into deeper understanding. Teach us to ask faithful questions and open our minds to new ideas. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of creation, mend the earth. Cool, warming oceans, and preserve melting ice caps. Increase our awareness of changing climate patterns and reveal new approaches to the ecological challenges we face. Especially, Lord, be with all those firefighters out west who are putting their lives on the line to save lives and property. Shield those in the paths of hurricanes or tropical storms. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of all nations, direct our leaders. Grant them courage to lay aside political grudges and renew their determination to address difficult conflicts. Guide them in the work of reconciliation. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of compassion, tend to the wounded. Rescue those tormented by mental illness or mired in addiction. Ease the anxiety of those struggling with dementia. Come quickly to help all who are grieving and all those who suffer. Be with Jamie Fisher and family due to the death of her 20-year-old son. And be with also Barry Hartshorn. God, in your mercy. God of beauty, inspire artists. Bless those whose visual and musical gifts enliven this assembly. Bless the creative work of poets, hymn writers, composers, painters, sculptors, and others that enrich our worship and daily life. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of resurrection, bring us to new life. Give us the living bread from heaven through which we abide in your love. And on the last day, raise us with all the saints to eternal life. God, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We lift these and all our prayers to you, O God, confident in the promise of your saving love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated. By the way, that hymn that we just sang is by Fred Pratt Green. I think he died in 2000. Interestingly enough, he wrote that hymn in 1972, which is the year I graduated from seminary. This is kind of ironic here. Take a moment while I prepare the table.
Thank you.
It's really not so much preparing the table as it is getting the gloves on. This one little finger that I injured playing pickleball a couple of years ago just refuses to cooperate.
But some calcium powder in there.
There you go. That's probably what I need. Okay. Now I'm ready.
Oh,
Upon you now and forever.
Amen.
closing in.
Thanks be to God.